I'll dive right in and describe the anatomy of a poison ivy compromise, and along the way I'll describe some of poison ivy's lower level functionality. Now I did a separate video on remote access tools that you may wish to view if you aren't already familiar with this concept. So first of all, the attacker is going to configure a poison ivy server, and really by configure what I mean is he's going to specify various parameters through the Poison Ivy graphical user interface that's provided in the Poison Ivy toolkit to help set up a server. And among other things, the attacker will specify things like his location on the internet, and this is primarily used so that the server ultimately can connect back with the attacker, and the attacker can then control his victim. The attacker will also specify a password, and this password is actually used in the context of generating a cryptographic key, and that cryptographic key is ultimately used to protect the confidentiality and the integrity of communication between the attacker and his victim. And the toolkit will basically, taking these parameters, will generate a file, and this file is basically going to be a server file. And the server file will actually be fairly small. The server file will literally be in the order of, on the order of about tens of kilobytes in size. So it's a very, very small file in the grand scheme of things. And the attacker is then going to try to take this server, and he's going to attempt to deliver this payload, this server, onto a victim's system. And the delivery mechanism is largely going to be orthogonal to the rest of the Poison Ivy attack. It relies on separate techniques. For example, common techniques for being able to deploy a Poison Ivy a server, or really any type of malicious payload, include things like social engineering. So for example, the attacker might try to use a spear phishing message to trick a victim into installing the server on its own system. The attacker may also, even in this capacity, might trick a victim into opening up an attachment, for example, via a spear phishing message. Or the attacker might have, might send a spear phishing message with a attachment with a Microsoft Office document on it, where the Office document contains exploit code for a Microsoft Office vulnerability that in turn is used as a conduit for getting the Poison Ivy server onto the victim system. So really, there are a host of ways. We talked about spear phishing, exploitation is another way. But the main message here is that these ways aside, they are orthogonal to the rest of the process involving Poison Ivy. They really are just a way to deliver the Poison Ivy server payload onto a victim system. Now, when the Poison Ivy server is installed onto the victim systems, it basically tries to hide its own traces via a number of mechanisms. For example, Poison Ivy is known to use techniques like process injection, whereby it can hide itself by appearing to or effectively co-opting an existing Windows process. It also tries to maintain a degree of persistence on the system. For example, it will place registry keys in locations whereby whenever the system is booted up, the Poison Ivy server will then launch on startup. So after this initial installation, the Poison Ivy server, which is now on the victim's machine, will call back to a piece of client software that's located on a remote machine and is controlled by the attacker. And if you recall, the initial callback is going to be facilitated by the fact that the configuration of the server actually does include a location. So the attacker, or rather the victim in this case, the victim's computer will effectively know where to call back to find the attacker. So there's effectively a callback that occurs as part of the installation of Poison Ivy onto a system. The first phase of this callback involves what is known as a challenge response protocol. And if you're not already familiar, challenge response protocols are actually quite commonly used in cryptographic protocol design. They are very familiar in the realm of people who work in that field. And really what happens in the context of a challenge response protocol is that the server on the victim's machine will basically issue a challenge. So imagine you have the Poison Ivy server, and the Poison Ivy server is going to be on the victim's system. There'll be a message sent from the victim system to the attacker, and this message will contain what is a challenge string. A challenge string in this case will basically just be a random looking string, and the attacker will have its client running here, which will effectively receive the challenge. So I'm just going to mark this as the attacker's client here, that's got a poison ivy GUI on it, but this client will receive the challenge, and based on the challenge, the attacker's client will construct what is known as a response to the challenge. And in this particular case, the response to the challenge will actually be the encryption of the challenge string using the encryption key that is actually derived from the password specified by the attacker when he set the attack up. So you can think of it as an encryption using the password effectively as a key of the challenge string. And that is that how the response is formed by the attacker and sent back to the victim's system. Now, the actual encryption algorithm that is used in Poison Ivy is an algorithm known as Camellia. It's a very well-known block cipher encryption algorithm, and it's fairly well-regarded. In particular, Poison Ivy uses Camellia with a 256-bit key, also a 32-byte key if you prefer to think in bytes. But ultimately, this key is actually derived from the initial password, and actually in a very simple way. What the attacker actually does is he'll take the password and he'll concatenate a whole bunch of zeros to the end of the password until he actually gets a value that is exactly 256 bits, and then that 256-bit value is then used to encrypt the challenge string to provide a corresponding response string. So after the attacker sends back the encrypted string, the victim's server, in this case, will decrypt the encrypted string that it receives back, and it will see if the decrypted string matches what was originally sent. And that should be the case. If the challenge was sent initially and the challenge was encrypted, the decrypted version of the challenge should match the original challenge. In other words, when you do something and you reverse the operation, you should get back what you started with. If you didn't, then something was wrong in that process. And in particular, if the victim's server can correctly decrypt the response and get back the original challenge, that serves as an indicator that the client possessed the right key and that the server has some assurance, more or less, that it is talking to the right client. So effectively, what this challenge response protocol does is it ensures that the right client is talking to the right server, because the challenge response protocol would only work, for that matter, if both the client and the server happen to know the same password. If they knew a different password, then the challenge response protocol would fail, because when you decrypted the response, you would not get back the original challenge, if that makes any sense. At this point, the attacker's client might start to do things like install additional Poison Ivy plugins, or it might update various Poison Ivy components and so on and so forth. Once the challenge response protocol has been completed, they know they're talking to the right parties, they can go ahead and start doing whatever it is they want to start doing at that stage. But perhaps more importantly, it's at this stage that the attacker now has real carte blanche access to the victim system. He'll be able to really do anything he wishes on the victim system using the graphical user interface of Poison Ivy to essentially control that system interactively. Now, by carte blanche access, as I mentioned in the previous video on remote access Trojans, I mean that the attacker can do things like record the victim's keystrokes, take screenshots of the victim's system, spawn remote shells, modify and retrieve files from the victim's system, modify the Windows registry, see what the system has installed on it, see what processes are running on the system and kill any active processes, determine what network connections exist and even kill those network connections, view and control services, and so on and so forth. So clearly, that is quite a list of things the attacker can now do once Poison Ivy or a similar remote access tool is actually installed onto the victim's machine. And so hopefully this video gave you a flavor of what an attack looks like with a remote access tool such as Poison Ivy.